Hey there, you are on my YouTube channel. I was able to open a YouTube channel because these three guys created it back in 2005. But they were able to create YouTube because of the internet. And the internet was invented by Robert E. Kahn and went surf. We can literally keep going back like this. My point here is this. Just look at how many inventions and inventors had to come together to produce one outcome, to make this moment of interaction between you and me possible. All of our inventions are interdependent. So using the internet is impossible without having a satellite in the space. But to send a satellite into space, we need a rocket. And the story of rocket is the interesting one. It spans across centuries and the generations of rocket scientists. Today, we are able to launch a space missions because in the 18th century, a poor scientist from Russia devoted his entire life to this field and also because of the events which occurred during and after World War II. Hi guys, welcome to Eclectic. Here we talk about history, philosophy, politics and future tech. So if you are interested in any of that, consider subscribing. Historians believe the Chinese developed the first real rocket around the 1st century AD. They were used for colorful displays during religious festivals, similar to modern fireworks. For the next few hundred years, rockets were mainly used as military weapons. Today, we are dreaming about colonizing the Mars and becoming a multiplanetary species. And we can only do it because of the hard work of these three guys. Without them, it would have been impossible to even think of sending a satellite to space. In the modern era, those who work in spaceflight today often acknowledge three fathers of rocketry, who helped push the first rocket into space. Only one of these three survived long enough to see rockets being used for space exploration, the poor visionary. Decades before the invention of car, the Russian visionary Konstantin Tsiolkovsky was busy in forming the theoretical basis for space travel. Tsiolkovsky lived most of his life in poverty and isolation. As youth, he spent most of his life in the library, reading science journals, learning Newton's laws of motion and applying them to space travel. In the era when people were using horse carts for city-to-city travel, Tsiolkovsky was dreaming about traveling to the moon and Mars. Without any help from scientific community, he figured out the mathematics, physics and mechanics of rocket. He also calculated the escape velocity of the Earth, which is the speed necessary for a rocket to escape the gravity of the Earth. In 1903, he published his famous rocket equation, which allows one to determine the maximum velocity of a rocket when given its weight and fuel supply. The equation revealed that the relation between speed and fuel is exponential. Normally, one might assume that if you want to double the velocity of a rocket, you simply need to double the amount of fuel. But instead, the amount of fuel you need rises exponentially with the change in velocity. Tsiolkovsky's equation made it clear that the rocket needs enormous amounts of fuel to leave the Earth and to get an extra boost in speed. Without caring about people who made fun of him and his poor economic condition, he kept working tirelessly. Tsiolkovsky's guiding philosophy was this: the Earth is our cradle, but we cannot be in cradle forever. Tsiolkovsky was too poor to convert his mathematical equation into actual model, but his equation helped next generation scientists like Robert Goddard to actually build the prototypes. Robert Goddard first became interested in science as a child when he witnessed the electrification of his hometown. First, he began experimenting with kites and balloons. Then Goddard effectively figured out ways to apply Newton's laws to rocketry. He invented usable scientific tools by introducing three new innovations. First, Goddard experimented with different types of fuels and realized that powdered fuel is insufficient. The Chinese had invented gunpowder centuries earlier and used it for rockets. But gunpowder burns unevenly, and hence rocket remained a mere toy for centuries. Goddard's first innovative idea was to replace powdered fuel with the liquid fuel because liquid fuel can be precisely controlled. He built a rocket with two tanks. One tank contained a fuel such as alcohol, and other tank contained an oxidizer such as liquid oxygen. Goddard realized that as the rocket rose into the sky, its fuel gradually decreased. So his next innovation was to introduce multi-stage rockets that can get rid of empty fuel tanks and therefore could lose some weight along the way. This increased the rocket's range and efficiency. His third innovation was the gyroscope. It is a device used for measuring or maintaining orientation and angular velocity. Goddard realized that he could use gyroscopes to keep his rockets on target. In 1926, he made history with the first ever successful launch of a liquid-fueled rocket. It rose 41 feet into air, stayed in the air just for 2.5 seconds, and landed 184 feet away in the cabbage peach. Despite this success, Goddard's colleagues and many prominent media outlets made fun of him. When scientist community and media found out that Robert Goddard is giving serious thought to space travel, the New York Times published an article which mocked and questioned Robert Goddard's knowledge about the rocketry. In 1930s, there was a misconception that rockets will not be able to move in the vacuum of outer space. However, Newton's third law, which states that every action has equal and opposite reaction, very much applies to space travel. In a rocket, the action is the hot gas ejected out of one end, while the reaction is the forward motion of the rocket that propels it, even in the vacuum of space. Goddard died in 1945 and did not live long enough to see the apology written by editors of the New York Times after the Apollo moon landing in 1969. Rockets for war and peace. In the first phase of rocketry, we had the dreamers like Tsiolkovsky, who worked out the physics and mathematics of the space travel. In the second phase, we had people like Goddard, who actually built prototypes of these rockets. In the third phase, rocket scientists worked with the major government during and after World War II. In this phase, rockets were first used as the weapons of mass destruction and then for the space exploration. Baron Werner von Braun was one of the most celebrated rocket scientists. He worked on the sketches and prototypes of his predecessors and tried to develop and perfect them. After completing his PhD, von Braun spent most of his time working for the Berlin Rocket Society, an organization that used spare parts to build and test rockets. Von Braun might have become a professor of physics at some German university, but war was in the air, and all of the Germany, including the universities, were being militarized. Unlike the Robert Goddard, who could not convince the US military to fund his projects, von Braun got heavy funding from the German government under Hitler. German military wanted to use von Braun's knowledge for building the weapons of mass destruction. Under von Braun's leadership, the scribblings and sketches of Tsiolkovsky and the prototypes of Goddard became the vengeance weapon, the V-2 rocket. The V-2 set a number of records, shattering all past achievements in terms of speed and range for a rocket. It was the first long-range guided ballistic missile, was the first rocket to break the sound barrier, and most impressively, it was the first rocket ever to leave the boundary of the atmosphere and enter outer space. Unfortunately, this revolutionary invention was only used for terrorizing London and blowing up entire city blocks. Suddenly, it appeared as if the future of Europe and Western civilization itself might hinge upon the work of a small isolated band of scientists led by von Braun.
The Germans, defeated in World War I and restricted by the Treaty of Versailles, turned to new arms. Military rocketry experiments started as early as 1929, before Hitler's rise to power. By 1932, Walter Dornberger had gathered around him in the Army Weapons Department a specialist staff, headed by a 19-year-old prodigy, Werner von Braun, a name now famous in the unfinished narrative of space flight.
However, Germany lost the World War II. Von Braun and 100 of his assistants surrendered to the Allies. But hey, what happened to the V-2 missiles which were stocked up in the Germany? Soviet Russia and United States captured those missiles. They sent those missiles to their respective countries so that scientists can study them, reverse engineer them and build the new ones. The entire US and Soviet Union arsenals were based on the process of modifying V-2 rockets. Rocketry and superpower rivalry. One of the major goals of both United States and Soviet Union was launching the first artificial satellite. The Soviet Union took the basic V-2 design and quickly built a series of rockets based on it. Soviet Union outperformed the United States and became the first country to send an artificial satellite to space.
Then, its casing opened. The springs snapped, and the nose cone was pushed out of the way. A ball with four antennae emerged to go it alone in the darkness of space. And a radio began to send a signal back to Earth. Humanity had entered the space age.
October the 4th, 1957, the world's press announces the miracle of the age. The Russians have successfully launched the first satellite ever to circle the Earth.
This is how Americans reacted after Soviet Union became first country to reach space.
Today, a new moon is in the sky, a 23-inch metal sphere placed in orbit by a Russian rocket.
The reaction was one of astonishment and concern, for it was now known that a potential enemy was at least temporarily ahead in developing means for space travel.
President Eisenhower reassures the nation that Russia's success with the first satellite does not indicate a serious lag in American rocket research.
I promised the Secretary of the Army that we would be ready in 90 days or less.
But meanwhile, far across the country at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, a sprawling 80-acre research and development complex in Pasadena, California, scientists and engineers were racing toward the same deadline, 90 days to put a satellite into orbit.
At Cape Canaveral, Florida, the Army's Jupiter C rocket is readied for America's second attempt to launch a space satellite. The hours-long countdown approaches zero, a moment of enormous tension, for every missile launching is still an experiment. Any one of tens of thousands of things can go wrong with catastrophic results. But all that can be done to assure perfection has been done. The moment is at hand. The countdown reaches zero. Some 3 minutes later, Explorer is in orbit, broadcasting to the world its coded scientific data. This close-up of the United States edition of Sputnik was made at a press conference with leaders of the scientific teams, Dr. Werner von Braun, Dr. James Van Allen, and Dr. William Pickering, a three-way collaboration between private industry, academic science, and the military. Cosmic ray intensity, meteor impact, solar radiation, these are the dry facts that will help carry a man ever farther into the age of space.
Since then, we have sent more than 8,000 satellites to space. Scientists of 21st century are talking about making humans a multiplanetary species, establishing a permanent moon base, colonizing Mars and mining the moon. But without Tsiolkovsky, Robert Goddard and von Braun, we could not have achieved this feat. Only one of them stayed alive to see the dream of reaching space being fulfilled. The other two, however, died decades before seeing how their work helped us in reaching the space. Tsiolkovsky and Robert Goddard never got the respect or acknowledgement they deserved while they were alive. Still, they kept working and bestowed their work upon the next generation. They both died, but their work stayed alive and inspired the generations of rocket scientists. And at the end, here is a gentle reminder of what this channel is all about. At my channel, I make videos on our past, our present, and our possible future. In that process, I cover topics like history, philosophy, politics, science, technology, and the social issues of 21st century and much more. So consider subscribing if you are interested in any of that. Go ahead, check out the playlist and videos that are already available. Subscribe if you find them interesting, and also I assure you that more interesting content will keep coming up. If it is possible for you, economically support my channel on patreon.com.